الطير أغناها وقد جابت سما كم مرة قد ضقت من عظم البلاء بشر وشيطان يحاصرني أبا كم مرة قد أظلم الدرب.
Bismillahir Rahmanir Rahim. Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh. How is everyone doing today? Alhamdulillah, we're in the new Islamic year. We're in the month of Muharram. Subhanallah, one of the blessed 4 months. And today or yesterday, depending on which calendar you follow, we are fasting. Well, I'll be fasting today, inshallah. It's Ashura. As obviously the famous hadith regarding fasting, the 9th and the 10th. Whilst we are fasting and following the sunnah of the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam, who informed us of fasting for relief or forgiveness of the sins, we have the opponents who will be basically mourning, whipping themselves to a frenzy, slicing their heads open, even to the point of slicing their children's heads, you know, no sense of humanity. But they argue, because the tragedy of Karbala, now whilst we're on the topic of Karbala and the tragedy that took place, I recommend you to read my brother's book, Farid, Allah yahfadak, The Martyrdom of Al-Hussein. If you haven't purchased it, wallah al-azim, it's a brilliant book. It provides authentic narrations in relation to the tragedy of Karbala, so please purchase this book. And as my brother Farid has put in the back of the book, he says, however, another disaster is that the martyrdom of Al-Hussein radiallahu anhu has devolved into a Greek tragedy, one that pushes away those that are rational due to fabrications and distortions that have tarnished his great image. There you go. My brother Farid couldn't put it any better. So here you go. Purchase his book. You know, it's very, 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 very insightful. Very short as well, but it gets to the point with authentic narrations. Now, whilst we're touching on the topic of Ashura, and unfortunately, the battle of Karbala took place on the 10th of Muharram in the year 61 after the Hijrah of the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam. We've been long accused by the Shia of fasting and celebrating the day of Ashura in sort of spitefulness, like, you know, they're mourning, so hence we have now celebrated Ashura by fasting, as the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam said, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala saved Musa alaihi wasallam. This is totally incorrect. As Shaykh al-Islam Ibn Taymiyyah mentioned in his Majmu' al-Fatawa, that this is incorrect regarding that Ahle Sunnah wal Jama'ah do not celebrate Ashura. We don't celebrate this as an Eid. This is a day that we fast because Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala saved Musa alayhi salam, and we thank Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. It's not a celebration at all. We would say, rather than bringing authentic narrations from Ahle Sunnah wal Jama'ah or from Sunni sources to highlight the, you know, rewards or the instruction from the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam to fast on this day, what do Shia narrations have in relation to the fasting of Ashura? Do they have anything at all that mentions the fast of Ashura? Okay, so let's dwell into this and get into their books and see exactly what the infallible imams have recommended and what they've advised us. Okay, it's only fair. Okay, so let's get into it straight away. This is Al-Jami'u Lil-Kutub Al-Arba'a, and this is Tahdib Al-Ahkam by At-Tusi. Okay, and as you can see on screen, it mentions by At-Tusi, who's Shaykh Al-Ta'ifa, he says, وَأَمَّا صَوْمُ يَوْمِ عَشُورًا, as for the fast on the day of Ashura, فَقَدْ وَرَدَ فِيهِ التَّغْرِيبُ فِي صَوْمِهِ, that it has been narrated in encouragement to fast. Okay, to fast in it. So there's been encouragement to fast on the day of Ashura, according to Shaykh At-Tusi, because there's been narrations, it's been mentioned in narrations that there's encouragement to fast. There's narrations that indicate the virtues of fasting Ashura. Okay, then he says, or encouragement to fast, obviously encouragement meaning rewards. وَقَدْ وَرَدَتِ الْقَرَاحِيَةُ أَيْضًا أَمَّا مَا رُوِيَ مِنَ التَّغْرِيبِ فِي صَوْمِهِ فَقَدْ رَوَى. He says that, but there's also narrations that are mentioned, okay, there's also narrations that are mentioned for dislike, okay, disliking fasting in it as well. The narrations that mention that, you know, it's not good to fast in Ashura, we will show you what other scholars, contemporary scholars have said regarding these narrations, whether they're authentic or not. But he also says, as for what's been made mention of encouraging to fast in it, it's been mentioned. And as you can see, it's been narrated by Mas'adat bin Sadaqah and Abi Abdillah and Abihi Anna Aliyan Qala Sumul Ashura'a Sumul Ashura'a Tasi'a Wal Ashira فَإِنَّهُ يُكَفِّرُ الظُّنُوبَ سَنَى. He states that Abi Abdullah narrated from his father, Imam Baqir alayhi salam, that Ali radiallahu anhu said, fast the 9th of Ashura and the 10th of Ashura, for indeed it forgives the sins for the year. Okay? So it forgives your sins for the year. So when we fast the 9th and the 10th, this is encouraged and recommended by Ali radiallahu anhu. So if you have a problem with Ahle Sunnah fasting on the 9th and the 10th of Ashura, then you've got a problem with Ali radiallahu anhu. And if you argue, well, you're following a Jewish tradition, because the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam says, we are awla to Musa than the Yahud, then we'll say, well, all right, then Ali radiallahu anhu is, if you're going to use that argument against us, we'll say, all right, then if you want to play that game, then Ali radiallahu anhu, you got to accuse him of the same thing, because he says fast the 9th and the 10th like we do. Okay? So what you've got to say for yourself? What about cutting yourselves open stupidly with rods and knives and axes? And so where is it been narrated that you crawl, you know, like cockroaches on the floor, and you mud and you roll over, you know, on mud like pigs, etc.? And the narrations you bring regarding Ahle Sunnah wal Jama'ah, you know, that are making a stupid qiyas by saying the Prophet ﷺ was informed by the death of Hassan radiallahu anhu. Yes, we know this. So don't think we don't know about narrations from Ahle Sunnah wal Jama'ah, most notably the authentic narration from Salama, that the Prophet ﷺ foretold or prophesied of the martyrdom of Hassan radiallahu anhu. We know this. So don't think we don't know about these narrations. But what we as Ahle Sunnah wal Jama'ah don't do is behave like buffoons and treat this tragedy like my brother Farid says, like a Greek tragedy and a carnival, like a festive carnival. And I'm going to play videos to show you the ridiculous amount of activities and plays and, you know, just diabolical practices that you get up to during this day, which is supposed to be fasted, by the way. You don't slice your heads open. You're supposed to fast, as Ali radiallahu anhu mentioned. Now let's narrate another hadith. And it's narrated by Abi al-Hasan alayhi salam. Qala sama Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam yawma ashura. That Abi al-Hasan alayhi salam said that the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam fasted Ashura. The Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam fasted Ashura. Okay? He fasted the 10th of Muharram. So why don't you follow the sunnah of the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam? So we're following Ali radiallahu anhu by doing so. And likewise, Abu al-Hasan confirms, who's in your infallible imam, that the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam fasted the 10th of Muharram, fasted the Yawm al-Ashura. So what's your problem with us? And likewise, there's another hadith, as you can see, is narrated by Abdullah bin Maymun al-Qadah and Abi Ja'far an Abihi alayhi salam qala siyamu Yawm Ashura'a kaffaratu sana. That the fast, and Abi Ja'far and Abihi, so his father, narrated and said that the fast of the Yawm al-Ashura, or Siyamu Yawm Ashura, that the fast of Ashura is an expiation of the sins for the year. More notably, the hadith, which is very important, that Ali radiallahu anhu himself encouraged and said, fast the 9th and the 10th. So why don't you fast on the 9th and the 10th? It's clearly confirmed by Tusi, who said there's a hadith that mentioned the encouragement of fasting. As you can see, we are the true followers of Ahle al-Bayt. We are following the Ahle al-Bayt. Not you slicing your heads like animals. Now, these three narrations are also mentioned in Wasail al-Shi'a by Hur al-Amalin. As you can see on screen, it quite clearly shows you the three narrations that I quoted. Okay? It shows you the three narrations that I quoted. And in volume 10, page 457, it mentions the three narrations that I've mentioned. Now, one may argue that, yeah, you did read out from At-Tusi, Sheikh Al-Ta'ifa, that there's narrations that mention the encouragement of fasting Yawm al-Ashura, but there's also narrations that mention not to fast in Ashura. regarding obviously the dislike of fasting Ashura. Now, let's go to one of your contemporary scholars who is the main Ayatollah, the grand Ayatollah before Sistani, Ayatollah Khoi. Okay, and as you can see, the book from Ayatollah Abul Qasim Al Khoi, okay, one of the greatest Shia Hadith scholars and teachers. And as you can see from his book, Al Mustannad fi Sharr Al Urwat Al Wuthqa, okay, Ayatollah Al Khoi, he says, in any case, the narrations which prohibit or frown upon are on the whole not clean in their narrator chains, meaning their sanad, but they are even weak, all of them. So the ahadith that mention, you know, or prohibit or frown upon the ahadith of that frown upon the fasting of Ashura are even weak according to Ayatollah Khoi. While on the other hand, those narrations which include an order or recommendation for fasting this day are many, like the Sahih narration of Qadah, fasting Ashura is an expiation of a year. Hadith of Ibn Sadaqah, fast Ashura, the 9th and the 10th, for it expiates the sins for a year. Ayatollah Khoi, okay, Ayatollah Khoi confirms that the narrations of fasting Ashura, the 9th and the 10th, and he confirms the Sahih Hadith of Qadah, and he confirms that these hadith are many, and the Sahih authentic narrations confirm the encouragement of fasting the 9th and the 10th. And the ones that are the hadith that are frowned upon, or meaning the hadith that mentioned that fasting Ashura is frowned upon and disliked, they are weak, all of them, according to Al-Khoi. So now I ask you a question: are you going to replace your pagan-like festivals, wailing and jumping in the air and lions and, you know, zombies and cutting your head and cutting your children's heads and crawling like cockroaches, and even some of them changed like dogs, and all sorts of bid'at which the Ahle Bayt are free from. Ahle Bayt are free from these practices, nor are they encouraged in any narrations of yours. And to prove this, let's listen to one of your Ayatollahs, Kamal al-Hadri, confirm what I've been saying. Let's listen.
ما أدري واضح أعزائي القضية الأصلية وين؟ وإلا إحنا ما عندنا دليل على التطبير، ومن يقول ذلك فهو إما جاهل وإما كذا وكذا. عزيزي إحنا ما عندنا دليل مولانا على السكاكين والقامات وإخراج أصوات الكلاب والحيوانات والمشيك البهائم مولانا، ما عندنا ذنب مولانا. هذه اللي الآن هاي الممارسات التي أنتم تسمعونها يمينا ويسارا هنا وهناك، هذه لا توجد عندنا في النصوص المعتبرة لا قرآنيا ولا ماذا ولا روائيا. السؤال إذن من أين دخلت هذه الممارسات؟
Where have you got this from? This is ludicrous. This is what we say. You romanticize the tragedy, and as it states by my brother Farid, you've devolved this into a Greek tragedy. You know what I mean? It's not rational at all. So we would now present narrations, okay, from your books, to advise you what Hussein radiallahu anhu actually advised his family in the midst of the battle. We will see who follows Ahlul Bayt. As the Prophet felt grief in the authentic narration of Salama in Mustadrak al-Hakim, he felt grief. He, you know, his grandson, he was prophesied that his grandson would be killed. And the Prophet had wahi that Hussein radiallahu anhu would be killed. And it's tragic, of course it is. If anyone reads, if you read the book, he goes into the authentic narrations, it's absolutely heartbreaking. But that doesn't mean in the name of Ahlul Bayt that you innovate practices which the Ahlul Bayt are free from. Would Ahlul Bayt be pleased? Just imagine Hussein radiallahu anhu's son, okay, who was alive today, Zain al-Abidin. If he was alive today, would he approve of these practices? Would he approve, even though he was the witness to what happened at the tragic event of Karbala? He won't approve of it. Nor would Imam Jafar, nor would Imam Baqir, nor would Musa al-Qadhim. You could mention all the Imams. Imam Muhammad al-Jawad, you know, Hassan al-Askari, Rida, name whoever. Would they be pleased? Ask yourself, ya ayyuha Shia. So now let's present what Hussein radiallahu anhu said about those who invited them. Now we're not saying that those Shia, we're going to get to other narrations that would advise us what Hussein radiallahu anhu told his family before his death. A lot of the blame, we're not saying, and hear me out, we're not saying the Shia killed Hussein radiallahu anhu. No, not at all. We're not saying the Shia killed Hussein radiallahu anhu. Whoever uses that argument is, to be honest, not being fair. It's not a real polemical argument to use. But what we say is they do share the blame. Those Shia Ali, now, you could say, oh, but there weren't 12 of us. So likewise, if those who were there at the time, okay, didn't give him his support, What makes us think you guys would have done the same? Just because you claim the love of Ahlul Bayt don't mean nothing. Don't mean diddly squat. So let's go into what Hussein radiallahu anhu said to the people that invited him. This is al-irshad fi ma'rafati hujjatillahi ala al-ibad. This is by al-Mufid, okay? And as you can see on screen, okay, as you can see on screen, Hussein radiallahu anhu said, didn't you write to me that the fruits had become ripe and that I would have an enormous army when I came? Okay, so Hussein radiallahu anhu is basically admonishing those who invited him and said, didn't you write to me to say that look, the fruits have become ripe, that you know, they gave him bay'ah and Muslim bin Aqil came and they betrayed him, and the call that Muslim bin Aqil, when Ubaidullah bin Ziyad came under the cover of darkness and Urwa bin Hani bin Urwa was killed and etc. Where were they? They betrayed him. So you see, Hussein radiallahu anhu actually admonished those who invited him before the battle. Whilst we agree that the army that actually killed Hussein radiallahu anhu and the noble Ahlul Bayt, like Hassan al-Basri said, he said that the majority of the Ahlul Bayt were killed in the Battle of Karbala and not anyone was comparable to them at that time. No doubt it's a tragedy. But likewise, the Shia of Hussein, meaning the Shia, those supporters, betrayed him. You know, and they share the blame for it as well. Think about the real reason why this tragedy unfolded. What I mean by unfolded, what led towards the martyrdom of Hussein radiallahu anhu, is the betrayers of Kufa. The Shia Ali, who then eventually became a Tawwabun, who wanted to be forgiven for their crimes, because they knew they betrayed him. So never forget that. Whilst we acknowledge the actual people that killed him were, have the majority share of the blame, but don't ever forget that the one that called him, the one that, you know, invited him, the one that pledged to him, the one that promised him support through Muslim bin Aqil, they're the ones that betrayed him. When the call of war came, when the cry of war came from Muslim bin Aqil, no one was there to help. He was left with nobody. And a Muslim bin Aqil radiallahu anhu was eventually killed and thrown from the palace. So now let's go into another narration. And look what Hussein radiallahu anhu said. Let's read the dua that Hussein radiallahu anhu made, okay, against the Shia. Okay, listen to this. As you can see, okay, as you can see, it's the same book, Al-Irshad, by Mufid. And if you look on screen, Hussein radiallahu anhu made a dua. Al-Mufid says, then Hussein radiallahu anhu raised his hands. He said, oh Allah, if you give them pleasure temporarily, then divide them to various groups and make the rulers oppress them. They have called us so that we may support them, and they betrayed us and killed us. Okay, this is the dua Hussein radiallahu anhu made, okay, against them. He said, if Allah give them temporarily pleasures in this world and make rulers oppress them. This is what Hussein radiallahu anhu made. He was absolutely disgusted by the ones that invited him, and he basically made dua against them.
غير أغناها وقد جابت سما
كم مرة قد ضقت من عظم البلاء بشر وشيطان يحاصرني أبا كم مرة قد أظلم الدرب